I have already sent letters to lawyer to bring a man or woman to claim under oath of the exact amount owed. They ignored it. Oh, good. You hope they ignored it, because that's just proof that you tried to settle the matter on a private side, and you are not exhausting all administrative remedies. They are, that they're acting in dishonor. You hope they ignore it, but don't keep sending the same thing back. What you do is you send, send a letter to the lawyer to bring a man or woman to claim under oath of affirmation. That's fine. You give them a notice. You say, I will be more than glad to continue with this communication if you are going to bring a man or woman forward who will verify in open court under oath of affirmation a true bill of the amount due. Without that true bill before the open court that will be verifiable, you're making a false claim. And if you don't stop with this is a form of harassment. If you don't stop with this moving a false claim against my person, you are causing me harm. You're stressing me out, and I don't need this nonsense in my life. Now, I'm suing you. So you better have somebody who's willing to bring that claim of a debt due in open court under oath of affirmation, or when the court is hearing your complaint or claim against me, I will also be moving a claim against you. No, it's not a cross-claim. It's not a cross-complaint. It's your own standalone cause of action and has nothing to do with their paperwork or their nonsense. All you're bringing up to court is they're administrating my right or attempting to administrate my property without right, or they are administrating my property without right. You make your claim. Say, somebody claimed that I owe them a debt. I tried to communicate back and forth with them on the administrative level, on a private capacity, on a private side. I tried to keep this out of the public realm. These people are forcing me, because they won't leave me alone, to bring this matter before the public in a public venue and wasting my resources and the public's resources on something that could have been resolved on the private side. You could say I tendered them an offer and they refused to accept the payment. And the judges all know whoever makes the proposal of a payment and the other side refuses the proposal of the payment dishonors the debt, and the debt is no longer due. So every judge knows that basic simple rule that goes back thousands of years. If you sent them an offer or proposal, it's like, look, I'll be glad to settle this debt with you. Please accept the fact that I'm low in funds right now, and the best I could do right now is $5 a day. If they refuse to answer, they only have basically have 3 days in which they could, but give them 14 days. If they refuse to answer, because the IRS gives you 3 days, and then within 10 days, the IRS seizes all of your bank accounts and liens up everything you got, or sends you a notice of lien, and they send you a notice of deficiency. So the IRS moves like lightning. They do it in 10 days. Give these guys 10 days, 14 days to reply. If they don't reply in 10 to 14 days, well, then that's proof that there is no longer a debt between the parties. Because you sent them, say, a registered letter that weighs only $2, and then you have a green card mailed back to you. And that way, when you move your claim before the court, you attach the green card to your as an exhibit saying that I tried to settle the matter on a private side. These people dishonored my proposal of settlement. They can't do that. They know the law. And since they know the law, ignorance of the law is no excuse, I move this court to let the record reflect that there is no debt now outstanding between the parties. That's one way. Let me see. How do you answer when the court compels you to answer discovery? What court? If it's your court, you set the rules, and nobody can order you to do anything in your court. Obviously, you're not moving a common law. Obviously, you're moving under somebody else's case number. Obviously, you haven't established your own case and created your own claim and filed your claim in a court that is competent to seat a jury. So that's the only thing I could think of here is how do you answer when a court compels you to answer discovery? You could always do the Gambino's John Gotti guys did is plead the fifth. Let me see what else it says here. I already sent letters to lawyers to bring forward. Okay. I tried that a few years ago. I sent them a tender of payment. They sued me. They won a court. Of course they won a court. Oh, man, in Alaska. I see that. Yeah, that's the man who's saying that the attorney's trying to bring a foreign judgment now into Alaska. Oh, yeah, they can bring a foreign judgment against you. That judgment is, that's a perfectly legitimate. Anytime you have a foreign judgment, oh, yeah, that foreign judgment could chase you any place where common law is competent to hear it. So they could drag you to England. They could drag you over to Australia. Oh, yeah, they could chase you around with a foreign judgment. Absolutely. Just like your marriage is going to be recognized no matter what country you go to, basically that has a common law jurisdiction. Yeah, I remember talking a while back, he's trying to collect. Yeah, all you have to do is simple. I explained this a million times. Who taught me this? I'm trying to remember which show that I listened to years ago that you folks can go back and listen to and just say, oh, that's not Carl's crazy belief, that's somebody else's. It's true. Because you folks all know UCC. You guys all know negotiable instruments. It's UCC 3, 501, 503, and 507. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows it's a ping pong match. Everybody knows whoever drops the hot potato loses. So you send him a proposal that you're willing to settle a debt. Throw it out there. You know, people say, oh, no, don't ever recognize that you owe it pay. If you want to play the debt game, it's really simple, and especially in this nation, and maybe in other countries it won't work. But in this nation, if you make it to a commercial entity, if you make it to a fiction, not to another man, and another man, you just basically have to say, please forgive me, and he basically has to do it. But in this country, with a corporation, you can play the old Trump card and say corporations were created to cause no harm to man. If a corporation causes harm to man, I could claim that they cease to exist, and I could say that they must cease and desist immediately anything that's causing me harm. And they have to abide by my wish, order, and demand. As a man, they cannot cause me harm. So right now, you're still on a two-dimensional playing field, which is fine. Stay two-dimensional. Stay a person. Stay a corporation. Stay in, you know, in a financial world, dealing on paper and pen. That's fine. Because that won't,
hey,
destroy, Carl? It won't destroy your credit. Yeah, who's this?
Hey, this is the Alaska guy. Hey, my wife was talking to me while you were answering that part about the courts. And I followed your I got the emails from you about sending the letters, you know, to what man or woman would they bring into court under oath or affirmation. And like mm-hmm. I said, they just ignored it. And then mm-hmm. they filed motions to compel and motions for sanctions against me. And,
okay. So what you would have to do then is you would have to open up your own case, and you could say, there is an entity causing me harm and making a false claim against my good name and my person, and I am making a claim now in a court of record, and I want to have this matter heard. You must answer me within 21 days, or I want to move the court for default judgment against you.
And is that in the federal common law court, or?
That's just normal local district court. Because you said he moved the foreign judgment to a local court, right?
Local district court in Alaska.
No, not federal or state court?
State court.
There you go. It's simple then. You just tell them, hey, you know what? I believe this man is, because see, that's what's bad. It's hard for me to tell you people this stuff because basically I'm telling you this is a bald-faced lie. But when you're doing it to a two-dimensional entity, you know what? They ain't got no vocal cords and they can't say he's bullshitting. You know, so you could basically just run over two-dimensional worlds like a freight train. But the only thing bad about that is, like I say to people, look, I showed somebody how to run over two-dimensional. I showed him how to run over Rent-A-Center like a freight train. So when he ran over Rent-A-Center like a freight train, he Mr. Not Rodenizer, what was his name? Hostetter. I told him, and Mr. Best, he's dead now, though. Yeah, Mr. Senior's dead. But they came to me one day, and they said to me, Rent-A-Center says I owe $300 for the sofa, and I've had hard times here. You know, he's a hill. You've seen the video of where I live. He lives down at the bottom of the hill. He's got like a little junkyard down at the bottom of the valley. So he says to me, times are hard right now, and I can't pay for my sofa. And they have a warrant and debt out here against me, and they're going to come, and they're going to seize the property out of my home. Should I just give it back to Rent-A-Center, or should I wait for the warrant and debt to be executed and the writ of attachment be attached to the warrant and debt? I said, well, why don't you just pay the damn thing off? And just keep yourself. He said, do you want to keep yourself? He said, well, yeah, absolutely. He said, do you want to keep your credit rating good with Rent-A-Center and everybody else in the world? He said, well, yeah, absolutely. I said, well, pay the damn thing off. I said, how much do you owe? He said, $300. I said, how much can you come up with? He says, well, about a dollar. I said, can you come up with a dollar a day, like $30 a month? He said, well, yeah. I said, how much do you owe him now? He said, $50 a month. I said, they'll gladly accept $30 or $50. He's like, oh, no, I went down there and I tried to talk to him, and they basically told me F off. Give me the damn money. We're going to come there and drag the sofa out with you kicking and screaming. I said, really? I said, did you bring anybody with you? He's like, no. I said, to the Mr. Best Senior, I said, would you have a problem going to Rent-A-Center with this man and watching him do this? Because he's going to need a competent witness to testify in court under oath affirmation. I said, it's better than having a third-party impartial witness. I said, so if you see anybody else standing around the counter, try to see if you can catch somebody standing around the counter that you really don't know. And then after you say it, what do you say? See if you catch the guy's name and number. See if you say, oh, yes, start a conversation with the guy. Say, oh, yeah, I went to school with your sister. Oh, yeah, I know who you are. And there you go. That way you're getting a third-party impartial witness all set up. I said, do you think you guys can handle that? He's like, well, yeah, sure. I said, now go down there and make them a proposal. He said, well, they're just going to tell me F off again. I said, good. Now you got your witness. Now you got your third partial witness. And you're going to call him in court. So he said, okay. He went down there, and I didn't hear nothing from this guy for like a month. So me and my sister, I was driving my sister down the road in her car before she got to her wreck. And they waved me down, the two old men. You know, the guy has a really long white ZZ Top beard. But anyway, he hands me a watermelon. I said, what's this for? He said, I won. I said, what do you mean you won? He said, well, we went to court. And I said, this judge is very good. I said, even though it's a small county, this judge is incredibly competent. I said, you will win. So he said, I did win. I said, yeah, I really don't like the judge, but I said, he knows law. I said, he knows both sides of the law. He knows common law, and he knows statute. He's really good. So I said, what happened in court? He says, well, when we went to court, he says, Renasena stated the claim, and he said everybody else was getting trashed by Renasena all day long. I said, there was a little redheaded lady lawyer for them. She said, yeah. He said, yeah, I've seen her. She's mean, man. She'll take a teething ring from a baby. she has no mercy. I said, yeah, good. I said, because I knew you'd beat somebody like her if she showed up, because she has no mercy. So I said, so what happened? She said, well, then it was not my turn to go. And I said to the judge, well, I went down to Renasena, and I offered them $30. And they told me they wanted all damn $50, or they told me they would come get a warrant of debt and a writ attachment and then drag the sofa out of the house. So I told them the best I could do was 30. And it's like, and, well, who's standing here next to you? It's like, well, I went down there next to him to witness that he did make that offer. So the judge said to the lady in the red, you know, to the attorney, she said, so this man went down there and said $30. So what do you say? You accept the man's $30 payment? She said, nope. The contract says $50.14. We won't take one damn dime less than $50.14. He said, the judge said, case dismissed. And then he's like, what? So to help you enjoy the sofa, have a nice day.